Well, welcome. So the program tonight, Selfies in Auschwitz, the Challenges of Holocaust Memory in a Digital Age. We have Dr. Jackie Feldman with us tonight from Ben-Gurion University of the Negev, which is in Israel, and he's going to talk about this really interesting topic. I do want to thank my friend Jilly Spear for organizing this. We've been actually trying to figure out how our two institutions can partner for a while, so this was very fortuitous that we were able to put this event together while you're still in California. So for those of you who are new to our museum, just real fast, I wanted to share that we're the oldest Holocaust museum in the United States. We were actually founded by survivors who met at Hollywood High School in 1961, and they wanted to create a safe space where they could not only remember family members who had perished, but also each one of them had an artifact, a photograph, a document, or some kind of precious object from before, during, or after the war. And they wanted to start displaying these objects and telling their stories to young people. So that's really how we got started. And our mission has always been grounded in teaching the critical lessons and social relevancy of the Holocaust in order to empower our visitors and students how to speak up and stand up against hatred, bigotry, and anti-Semitism. So that's a little bit about how we got started. We have an amazing, rich collection of artifacts. Only 1% of our collection is actually on the museum floor. We encourage you to please find time to come back and take a tour, and also to check out we have the USC Shoah Foundation Dimensions and Testimony exhibit. Are you guys familiar with that? The hologram? Okay, great. Well, you can spend time talking to Renee Firestone, who is turning 99 in April. So I wanted to thank, what is the shortcut again? American.
A for BGU.
Okay, that's. I just learned that tonight. Americans for Ben-Gurion University. I wanted to thank them for their generous partnership for hosting tonight's program. And I wanted to share a little bit about Ben-Gurion University. Ben-Gurion University has a unique role, not only as an educational and research institution, but also as the engine for growth of the entire Negev region of Israel. BGU has 20,000 undergraduate and graduate students representing diverse aspects of Israeli society on its three campuses in Beersheba, I probably can't pronounce this right, Steve Boker, and Eilat. The university's breakthrough science addresses some of the world's most pressing problems like cybersecurity, global health, and our environment. Directors of Development for Americans for BGU, Andrew Hoffer and Jilly Spear, sitting right here, are here this evening if you have any questions. Also, let them know if you would like to visit BGU on your next trip to Israel, and they can arrange a VIP tour. I'd now like to introduce Dr. Jackie Feldman, who is a full professor of anthropology at Ben-Gurion University of the Negev. He holds the Yaakov and Pariah Avnon Chair in Holocaust Studies and heads the Esther and Sidney Rabb Center for Holocaust Studies. He was an Israel Institute visiting faculty member at UC Berkeley in fall 2022. He has published two books and numerous articles in scholarly journals. Dr. Feldman's current research project, funded by the Israel Science Foundation and the German Association for Scholarly Research, is Memorial Museum Smartphone, Transmitting Holocaust Memory in a Digital Generation. This research examines how structures of authority, place, memory, and social solidarities change as a result of widespread digital technologies and social media. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Feldman.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming here in spite of the and through the traffic. I want to again thank Beth Keane, and Gene Maxey, and Michael Morgenstern here from the museum, and Jilly Spear and Andrew Hoffer of the friends of Ben-Gurion University for making this happen. Can you hear me, everyone, back there? Okay. What I'm going to explore, you see here, is selfies in Auschwitz. And to be clear, selfies of current day visitors in Auschwitz, right? And the Auschwitz Memorial Site. As a way of illustrating some of the challenges that digital technologies offer for Holocaust memory in the 21st century. Now, I've tried to summarize there some of the functions that Holocaust memory will have. So on the one hand, Holocaust memory, I'm conflating here, memory and education are to provide knowledge of the Shoah, what happened. Okay. It's also a question of mourning, right? Because we're not only accumulating facts, but very often it's a way of paying honor to the dead and the survivors through our learning about them. A third function is that of commemoration, which is not only to honor the past, but to create a sense of group, of belonging, of those who commemorate together. A further function, particularly in Israel, but in some other places as well, is that of nation building. You reinforce one's commitment to Israel through the nation by seeing oneself as heirs to the survivors, and thus increasing one's commitment to defense, to common action. And finally, right, ethics promote tolerance, combat prejudice, racism, hatred. One should not assume, right, as very often is elided in some ways, that every way of remembering the Shoah is going to serve all of these five functions at the same time, right? It may be to create a closed sense of group and create a sense of in-group and out-group rather than to see, okay, what happens if we were in the position of the other. It may provide knowledge but not offer commemoration, and commemoration may not offer a great deal of knowledge because it may be interested in stimulating emotion and singing together and commemorating together without transmitting a good deal of information. So that all of these things, right, they're overlaps, but they can be separated out. And it's important, I think, to think about Holocaust memory and Holocaust transmission and ask which of these functions, right, does a particular education program commemoration serve and which of them perhaps not. Now, there are two processes that are taking place right now at the turn of the, you know, we're past the turn, but beginning of the 21st century that together their coincidence, right, make for, I think, a lot of the problematic that I want to raise. One is that the question of distance from the those who lived through the Holocaust or those who survived it. And very often in the literature, you'll find that they're divided up by generational difference. There's a memory of first generation, second generation, third generation, and they'll be characterized by what kind of traumas do they have, what extent their memories are firsthand, what happens in the transmission. But one thing that's been looked at less is that memory is also, Holocaust memory is also a function of technology. So that if we looked at what Holocaust memory or how Holocaust was remembered, say through the 40s, 50s, and much of the 60s, the authoritative figures were the historians. And what historians did for the most part was to study documents. And the documents were those usually written by the perpetrators. So when there were survivors, and even if they wished to speak, and very often many of them didn't because the trauma was too fresh and they didn't want either to remember it or were afraid of transmitting that trauma to their children. But even if they did speak, very often they weren't heard, they were silenced. This is true certainly both in Israel and the United States for slightly different, but I think common reasons. People didn't want to hear that. And historians were the figures of authority, and they said, well, what do we need the survivors' stories for anyway? What did they know? They were just inside that camp, and they don't have the big picture, right? And so the how reliable is their memory after trauma and after several decades? So it's the historians who need to write present the Holocaust, and then the way that they was presented was through historical research, which favored documents. Now, these things began to change as a result, in particularly starting with the Eichmann trial that was broadcast on radio in Israel, on television, in other places, and particularly by the rise of the Yale video archives in the 1980s. So when there was this predates the Spielberg, right, project, and when the witnesses were now being recorded, then it became very often not so much what they said that was important, but what they could not say. So when they choked up, when they teared, the voice, the intonation of their voice, these became the marks of authenticity. I, at the time, was in the early 70s, was a student of City College of New York, and I took a year and a half of courses with Elie Wiesel. And Wiesel then, it's, I would say, in the American scene, put the survivor testimony on the map. And it was the way he spoke, the tone, the kind of emotive, that was perhaps even more important than the factual information that was transmitted. So that without, one would say, without video technology and the pictures, then what was not said very often could not be transmitted, because that tone of voice, the tearing that became a mark of authenticity, just wasn't available in the same way in written accounts. So technology changes what was not only what is remembered, but then the tone and the not speaking, the choking up, became the mark of authenticity, and in many ways ushered in what is called the age of the witness. Now, what happens when analog media goes over to digital? And rather than seeing a long testimony of witness, we get these little snippets, and these snippets that very often become interactive, right? And the interactivity meaning that it's not just what the witness says, but how do people react to it, and what do the people, the witnessee, those who are witnessing the witness, what do they say? To what extent does that change what counts as memory? So these two things of the death of the last of the witnesses, because there are very few today and will be very fewer as time goes on, witnesses, people, survivors who are still around and who are still transmit an intelligible testimony when most of them are in their 80s, 90s, or later. So the death of the last of the witnesses and the change in technology coincide. And then we ask, so is the age of the witness passing? And what will be, if so, what will be its replacement in a digital generation? Okay. Now, if I talked here about the witnesses, these are some of the changes that, and there can be more that are induced by digital media, right? Not only the witnesses became important, but over the last, I would say, 20, maybe 25, 30 years, visits to Holocaust sites, whether it be at Auschwitz or other sites in Poland or in Europe, have become important as part of Holocaust education. And in some ways, some museums bring artifacts and objects that partially perhaps recreate the experience of the site, right? Whether it be a boxcar, whether it be other things. But digital media provides also an immersive environment distant from Holocaust sites. One example I'll refer to is VR, virtual reality tours of Holocaust sites. Witnesses providing testimony at Holocaust sites and people putting on the headsets and spending anywhere from 15 minutes to some of them an hour, right, visiting these sites. So what happens? So now people have access to this, and as the technology improves and everybody can have perhaps the sound, the sites very cheaply on their headsets at home, that means that do they replace the Holocaust sites themselves as places of memory when people can see that in their homes? And then how does that change the what is the authority of gatekeepers. So if once one would have the school teacher, the museum, who was there to transmit knowledge or about the Shoah, today you've got an incredible amount that travels by Instagram, by TikTok, by all kinds of social media. So people are getting that information, and that information is much more rapid, much more abundant, and much more undifferentiated than what educators, people, curators of museums can control, right? So they're out of the control, if you like, of caretakers, of gatekeepers of memory. And third, digital media privileges other formations of social solidarity. So if you think for a minute of the museum visit or of the Holocaust Day commemoration, or of the visit to Auschwitz or to a death site right in Europe, one of the things that happened is that people have a sense of becoming a group because they've gone through this visit together and perhaps performed a ritual there that brings them together and senses, okay, we are the survivors, we remember. What happens to that we, as I'll show shortly, when people go and they stop and they take selfies and they're communicating with their friends on Instagram and being completely oblivious of the person standing next to them because they're not there. What's here is sending them out and getting the likes. What's here is the communication over Instagram rather than this face-to-face communication as a group particularly when commemorating, right? The Holocaust. So these are some of the changes that provide challenges to the way museums and educators have been transmitting, right, the Holocaust, in, if you like, in the pre-digital age. There are so many forms of Holocaust memory by now that are digitalized that I've just chosen a handful, and there are many more. And I'll give you some examples of these. Reconstruction, coloring of black and white victim photos. Navigational apps through memorial terrain. So instead of using your right Google Maps, right, you have a Holocaust application, so you can go around places in Europe and find who lived in the building, and then even if there's no marker there, by an app. Interactive Holocaust games. A tremendous gamut between those that are they're very educational, I would say, and a little bit dry. There's one about 15 years old already called Attentat 1942, put out by Charles University, and it would have it's a question of collaboration in Prague when the Nazis came in, and the question of how you and they use cartoons, they use actors, they use kind of a multiple choice. So the Gestapo is coming in, you've got this drawer. What is there in that drawer that may incriminate you? A statue of Jan Hus? No, that's okay. A Boy Scout badge? Uh-uh, those are Czech nationalists. That's going to get you in prison. So these kinds of things, choices, and there are those that are really kind of these action games of you know, escape from Auschwitz and, you know, kill the... A huge gamut of these things. TikTok testimonies and clips. So the idea is that perhaps one of the most widely spread was that in Israel produced about 4 years ago, I think, called Ava Stories. They said, what would happen? They took a diary, Ava Hyman, of a Holocaust victim from Hungary in 40 through 44. And then said, what would happen if the people during the Holocaust, if Ava had an Instagram? And they photographed the entire thing in a series of, I think, 1,000 or so episodes of 1 minute each, right, on TikTok. So people were downloading them and saying, and doing in the form of an Instagram, so posing for selfies or taking things in the form of Instagram. And people were watching this, and they got millions of views throughout the Holocaust Memorial Day and afterwards. So you could say, well, you know, but at the same time, it gets the kind of response that went way beyond, you know, how many people would watch, say, a documentary film. Navigational apps, I just spoke about that. Algorithm-generated conversations with survivor, quote, holograms. And again, you can see that dimensions of testimony. You can see a very good example downstairs. I just found out, went a few minutes ago and found out that the woman what's her first name? Renee Firestone? What? Renee Firestone actually came from the same town of 13,000 as my father. And then virtual reality tours of concentration camps, both at the camps in certain places, like at Bergen-Belsen, and then to be used right elsewhere. And then finally, selfies at Auschwitz. Now I'll run through some of these quickly and then focus on the selfies. So here you have this coloring. These are pictures of photos of prisoners at Auschwitz I, right? Polish prisoners, and they're all in black and white. And what they did is to restore the color. They're not like in the early 20th century where you'd kind of, you know, just paint in the black and white photos, but they have ways of analyzing the various shades of gray in order to reconstruct the colors as they were then. And because for younger generation today, if they're black and white, that's ancient history. And this allows, the idea is that this allows people to identify more easily with the prisoners because, you know, they look like someone from their class, perhaps, right? Or the navigational apps, here's one called Tracing the Past. And what they did, this one's in Berlin. And they went through all the documents. It's actually in Germany that's quite easy to do because you have phone books. And since in the late 30s, every Jew had to take on the middle name of Israel and women the middle name of Sarah, you go through the phone books of 1936 or 1937 and you can find a kind of reverse phone book, all of the addresses. And then by using the addresses, there are places in Germany, throughout Europe, that are marked by another project of little Stolpersteine, stumbling stones, that are kind of bronze, gold, gilded bronze stones that are set in the ground with their name, but many other places where there aren't there. And now with the help of this map, you can go make your way here through Germany and see exactly how many people were deported or killed from each town. And then go to the town, and then if you've downloaded the app, come to the building that's not marked, and then press the app, and the Roschheim family lived here, and were deported, and get a capsule information on that. So that's another app. And here, speaking with Ted, the holograms. Are you familiar? How many of you are not familiar with the hologram? Say downstairs or elsewhere, please. Okay. Then let me again, this is just a promo that was put out by USC, but let me just show you a minute or two of this so you get a sense, okay?
You know in Superman how at the Fortress of Solitude, Superman can speak to his father even though his father has long since passed away? Well, essentially what's happening there, Superman is having a nice fluid conversation with a recording of his father. Well, that very technology has arrived.
What do you hope people learn most from your experiences?
What I would like my legacy, my story, the legacy of my story to be.
It's called New Dimensions in Testimony and was developed by the University of Southern California's Shoah Foundation. That's the institute started by Steven Spielberg to help combat hate and violence, primarily by capturing stories of Holocaust survivors and helping to tell those stories in unique and compelling ways. Well, this certainly qualifies. It may just look like a big TV spun sideways on it, a Holocaust survivor telling his story, but what's happening here, you can sit down in front of him and just ask questions into this microphone and he'll answer as if he was sitting there in the flesh. Questions can be as basic as when were you born to deeper ones like what was the most horrific thing you experienced? Or
do you ever feel like you want to get revenge?
I'm not a revengeful person. So I wanted justice. Justice is not revenge.
Holocaust survivors have been speaking in classrooms for a couple of generations now and telling their story and engaging with young people. And we realize that opportunity is soon to be lost. And we wanted to try and capture that intimate moment by which when young people have heard the story of a Holocaust survivor, they can ask their own questions about their lives and the causes and consequences of their experiences.
Okay. And I invite you, those of you who haven't seen it, to come back come to the museum again, and you have here Renee Firestone, and engage her in a conversation and to see how these things work, the limitations, and also what one gets out of it. Okay. Now I come to the selfies. Okay. Now, worried about selfies. It's more than the last 10 years by now, but the idea of looking into a camera consolidates the selfie as a reflexive image. So in one sense, right, the question of selfies is the same as one posing for a photo that somebody else has taken at, someone else takes of you at the memorial site. But because of the two things, one is the rapidity of it. It's so fast that as you'll see here at the site, they will very often, okay, well, let me go back a minute. They will take a photo, right, stop at the site, take a photo, and very often in order to take the selfie, it's not simply, okay, here, snap the photo, but it's a kind of concentration, certainly if they want to be sent out, to get the lines right, to get the photo right. Think of how many shots very often are taken for selfies that are posted. So they may be standing right in front of the site, as we'll see here, the entrance to Auschwitz, for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes, in order to get all the lines and get the photos right, and then immediately send it out, wait for the likes to come back. So the result is that people are not in the present of walking into the site. They will have experienced it first when they get the like and they get the recognition, and then turn around and walk into the site. Also, it creates like photos, very often bottlenecks of people that are standing there in order to be photographed when other people want to be sort of alone or want to be in the present and to experience the site. And what they're seeing is, you know, a forest of selfie sticks. But this immediacy of the idea of one is kind of postpones part of the visit to the site of being there until the time that the like comes in, that they're sent out, and the like comes in and confirms, yes, I was there, okay? I've started here with a selfie, a rather unusual, which is not of at Auschwitz, but at the Holocaust Memorial Memorial for the Murdered Jews in Berlin, okay? And here, these are the selfies. This is a particular project. These selfies were posted on social media. And a German-Israeli, Shachak Shapiro, and one of the things that's done here, you'll see, especially on Sunday morning or Sunday afternoons, is that you have people who will play there, who will jump from stone to stone. It's called Steine hüpfen. Or who will play hide and seek among the stones of the memorial, sometimes couples making out and eating in the areas of the memorial. And what Shachak Shapira did was, these are images, the left-hand ones, that were posted on Twitter, on Facebook, on other areas of social media. And what Shapira did is to Photoshop them and to place, instead of the memorial, right, the piles of corpses, and then post them and said, if you want that photo removed, right, then send me a mail and apologize. And the people did that, and they apologized, and then you have another one, you see, and then their images were removed, right, from the net. Of course, this is something that, again, there were only a limited number of images and could be done, but is not effective in the long run because these selfies, these pictures travel on social media. They go from one platform to the other. And it's rare that one person kind of intervening can actually make the difference and stop these because they travel too quickly in order to be censored. So here I come to the selfies in Auschwitz. And here you see one, this case of an Israeli girl here with a group posing by Birkenau for the selfie. Here you see, let's see if I've got this one right. Okay, this was what we did for research is we took the most if you like, the most viral selfies at Auschwitz, the one that got the most likes or was tweeted or went the most. And it's this one. Brianna, I think her name was Thomas, called it Princess Brianna. You see here, she posted this. You see here of the composition that would have taken a long time just to get all the lines right, so that the four lines of the barracks then meet kind of symmetrically right behind her head. And then posted this and sent this out. And it this is about where now must over what are we 2012 about 10 a little over 10 years ago. Then she got, these are some of the reactions that she got online, right, from people. Then at the end, after she was appeared on various local TV shows, and then she said that actually she had gone, it was 1 year's anniversary of her father's death, and they had studied together World War II and the Shoah, and she had planned it as a memorial act. And then that sort of calmed things down a little bit, the criticism. I should point out, it's not all as simple as all that. Both here and elsewhere, women get criticized far more than men on these things. Right. Hair looks good, girl. Hair looks good, guy. No. To be fair, part of it has to do, right, with the way, not only with the selfie itself, but the way the smile and the way these things are framed. If you think about it a bit, there are photos, I'm not sure I have one here, but of politicians in visits in Auschwitz, right? And they are in some ways, selfies are the same thing, except that they know that they need to look away and get the picture at a 45 degree angle and look that they're looking very serious. But it's, in many ways, they form the same function as a selfie, even if the narcissism isn't always up there on the surface. And here, the reaction of the gatekeepers, in this case, those of the Auschwitz Memorial, was to some say, well, why don't you make the, just ban all selfies from the site. And actually, they do prohibit taking selfies or photos inside the gas chambers. But they sort of decide, well, you can't stop this. And so they decided to vet the sites. So you get certain selfies, right? Like these are like certain selfies that have kind of a serious expression and that will be posted, right? Thank you, look on the bottom. Thank you for sharing the picture. Thank you for remembering. We hope the visit was an important, memorable experience. And others like this one top left saying, there are better places to learn how to walk on a balance beam than the place that symbolizes deportation of hundreds of thousands to their deaths. So how would I summarize this about the selfies? On the one hand, the selfie broadcasts, right, I was here. And the selfie is more than a photo, right? Its speed, its interaction with networks away from the site, with the lack of interaction with those co-present, because one's focused on what the image is, right, and sending it out. And the vehemence of the opposition, I would argue, is saying that it desacralizes the dead, it's offensive, results not only from its innovation, but also, which I'd like to show in a minute, from its continuity with previous practices that were in some ways encouraged even by caretakers of the site. I'll illustrate. And some of the opposition, right, is an expression of great gatekeepers' reluctance to change, because these selfies are out there and they're being out there. And you say, well, let's stop all the selfies. Well, good luck, right? Here's what I mean by saying it's preparation, okay? Auschwitz-Birkenau has been a memorial site since 1947. The postcard that you see here on the right of Arbeit macht frei dates from the late 40s or the early 50s. So people who go to Auschwitz are ready 5, 7, 10 years after the site no longer functioned as a death camp, could buy postcards of the site that were being sold there. And the site, the postcards, all of them showed the area completely empty. okay, just the buildings, the postcards that were sold. And some scholars here argue that this is a way of making that site more immediate by placing the person in the site, because these sites place it in a past that's distant. And by seeing the person there being at the site, think for a minute about even the pictures that we send family or friends about significant sites. We're not only saying, hey, I was there, wish you were here. That's not the case here, but I was there, and so this is not something that's in the distant past. It's something that I that I saw, so you can see also. It's a way of pulling a person in to say, oh, she was there. I should go there too, okay? And there are other preparations for the site. What I want to say is this, if you see this, this is the kind of, I would say, iconic entrance, right, to Auschwitz I, right, the Arbeit macht frei gate. And here you see, this was a group that I had guided and observed in, we're over 30 years ago. Right? And you see that by the entrance against Israeli groups, so we have a lot of, right, flags and uniform, right, blue and white t-shirts. And you'd really get a traffic jam of people just standing here and being photographed. And I remember when I first went along with guided these groups in order to learn the groups so I could write about them, I had told the teacher and the students, I said, look, I want you all to leave your cameras here on the bus so that you remember that you're not visiting Auschwitz, you're visiting the ruins of Auschwitz, and you don't confuse the two. Impossible. The teacher said, but we need to show our friends and show our families. How else will we bear witness if we don't have the photos? Right? So this is already well before selfies. It was part of the preparation, the importance of photos. What's more, okay, those trips back then, so I'm talking about the early 90s, were guided by, or not were guided, were accompanied by survivors, okay? And the survivors came and would tell their story and would often mourn at places where they were. In this case, it's a memorial stone of where she was, not at Auschwitz, but at Treblinka, and would tell her story, right, to the people. And those ceremonies would end, this is with the survivor, reading the Kaddish over the ruins of the crematoria, at the end of a ceremony. And with the singing together, the person would read the Kaddish for his dead, the people would answer, they would sing together a memorial prayer. They would then end with the raising of the flags and the singing of Hatikva. And the survivor, in one form or another, right, would turn to the group and say, you know, kids, when I was last here, right, in this case, 45 years before, right, says, I never dreamed I'd come out of here alive. And now when I see you Israelis proud in body and spirit, I know that they didn't defeat us. Am Yisrael Chai, the people of Israel lives, bring many children to the nation so we live forever. Or fight, you know, for the state. So that already in these previous visits, right, what the survivor did was to say to the students that you, through your presence, you through being here in uniform, you through listening to me, you are the answer to my suffering. Or if you like, you are the witnesses of the witnesses, right? It's a word that they would use very often. So that these trips to Auschwitz were constructed, I would say the Israeli trips, and in a slight variation, American and other March of the Living trips, but maybe sometimes others as well, as a kind of a rite of passage where one would come in as a child, then identify with the victim in Poland, then come out as a survivor, and then through various other ceremonies be the sense of an ascender to Israel, and then come back kind of an adult, or at least claim they were empowered. So that the witnesses already were telling, the survivors, were telling students that, look, through your presence here, you're actually the witness of the witness. You are a redemption, in a sense, for my suffering. Okay. So that this notion of that the body of the visitor or the witnessee is a stand-in for the survivor, was already there before the selfies, and in some ways is being continued through the practice of broadcasting these selfies and saying, you see, I identify, I was there, we survived. And it takes another, or an additional step would be this, okay, which, well, let me show it to you. So that you see here, the right, this, you'd say, okay, you're taking a pop song and you're placing it here, the survival, you know, the, and then here the other is legitimized here by the survivor himself accompanying and initiating, right, this dance, and then telling or showing that his grandchildren, right, who were the ones who made this clip, are then being legitimized by the survivor, as you see now. So, okay, we can dance because we won. We won. You are the survivors. You are my survivors. So they didn't defeat us. And here, this is not only being done at the site, but then being broadcast right by social media. Again, this is about 10 years ago further. So I would argue this, that the body of the witnessee in the selfie replaces the body of the witness as the iconic site, right, or the site of Auschwitz or elsewhere, at a period particularly where there are very few witnesses remaining and will be less. So the idea is, okay, now we are the witnesses of the witnesses. And it was prepared by photographs, videos, rituals, which place the visitor of Auschwitz as representative and redemptive answer to the witness's suffering and survival. Right? One more, one last kind of representation, okay? Virtual reality, right, of Auschwitz. Over the last, I think the first of these, some of these were done, they're virtual realities that were done at one point by bringing a survivor to Majdanek and having him filmed with these, it's called Pepper's Ghost, these sort of these hologram-like technology so that it looks three-dimensional. And he would provide testimony inside many of the buildings in Majdanek where he was imprisoned. The VR virtual reality was particularly used at places like Bergen-Belsen that have been so thoroughly destroyed afterwards, again, for sanitary reasons in 1945, that you go through the site and you see memorials and you have no idea, it looks like green fields with memorial stones. So there, the VR people will go and put on a VR screen so that they can look at the field and then envision, you know, using footage of what the camp looked like, say, in, if not when it was in operation, then at liberation in 1945. But most of these VRs are now being made and being used off the site, okay? And they travel. So in Israel over the last year and a half, 2 years, two VRs have been made, one by a national religious group and one by an ultra-Orthodox group. And these are being shown particularly in a lot in ultra-Orthodox wouldn't call it a movie house, but auditoriums where they bring people together to watch this. They're tours of Auschwitz, but also they've most recently wandered and become a kind of being shown in a sort of tourist attraction. So in this one in Jerusalem, you have on the one hand, Time Elevator Jerusalem. It's kind of this tourist introduction to Jerusalem with seats that will shake when at certain points. And then you can also see here, going on a trip, 360-degree Auschwitz, right? And then, reality tour of Auschwitz-Birkenau, and here's an example of what this looks like. It's the ultra-Orthodox one.
The entrance of the Auschwitz-Birkenau concentration camp. Why enter such a horrible place? Why see, hear, experience? Because we're Jews. We aren't inquisitive visitors. We want to walk in the footsteps of our ancestors who pleaded, remember, and retell what became of us. We're about to enter a place of greatness and loftiness.
Okay. I want to ask this, sort of in kind of summarizing this. We have all these now digital representations, and this is a selection. There are many others as well. What, say, does the virtual reality do? Well, people come. On the one hand, it's meant to be a kind of full immersion, right? And I think it's only a question of very little time before they'll put smells into the VR. VR as well, put odor in as well. And so what does it mean to be there, and what's this importance of being there that these VR programs are supposed to do? In one case, right, they're meant to be units in and of themselves. People come to the auditorium, they buy a ticket, or they're brought there by a group. And they spend the ultra-Orthodox one is almost an hour long, which is almost dangerous, actually, in terms of the technology to be in a VR for an hour. And there's another one, which is being integrated into a museum where people near Ashdod in Israel, where people will walk into a boxcar, get an explanation there, then go into the VR of Auschwitz, and then come out of there and then be seated in a kind of reconstructed barracks. So on the one end, you can say, okay, these are different kinds of simply of technologies. But how do these technologies work, and how important is to create the simulation of people being there? And then if that becomes the everything, what's lost in that process of identification with the survivor? I survived, I was there, I just came out of Auschwitz, come on, let's go get a drink, right? What happens in these things? How do these things work, right? And I'm being a little bit vague because I'm not certain as to how these things work, and these questions haven't been researched yet, because this use of VR is still quite recent. It's only a matter of a couple of years. What happens then, can one create the sense of social solidarity between people when everybody is now still in groups with the VR? But again, as these things are marketed, sir, everybody will be able to just go into their computer and put it on in the privacy of their home, right? That's a larger question too. During COVID, we see commemorations that were done online. How do they work, and do they work, and to what extent? They're larger questions. And what does it do about in the need for you know, for mourning. I photographed this. This is the cemetery in Ungva, Uzhgorod, where actually my grandmother was buried, who died before the Holocaust. So one here follows, you know, through this cemetery and has the sense of mourning even, or I at least, in walking through this space. Will this continue to happen when one, you know, places a VR on, you know, in one's computer, when one sends out selfies? All these questions, if we go back to all of these things, right, the functions of Holocaust memory, and I'm not going to answer them, but what of these things are privileged by this need to sense and identify with the survivors through this being there of selfies or through this sensory simulation of the sense around VRs? And how much of this, right, perhaps get lost? More than that, you know, I think of not only the VR, but if it's all about just all about identification with the survivor, and I was there, and, you know, and encapsulated in the VR. Can these kinds of things of right application, you know, at all come to the fore? Because if it's all about he was the there was the victim, I am the victim, right? I am an answer to victimhood. Then what room does this leave for the processes, right, that led up to the Holocaust? There's a sense in which one cannot compare, one cannot really understand many of the processes. Everything is viewed from the eye of Auschwitz because it's like a black hole that swallows up everything. And if it's all about identifying with the victim, I'm the victim, I'm the answer to the victim, then what happens, right, to these questions? And perhaps let me leave it at that, and then perhaps if there are questions afterwards, I'll say, let me leave it at that, and I'll say a little bit about the Rab Institute and so on. So thanks very much.
I was so offended by seeing the survivor with the grandkids and dance moves or whatever they were doing. I just find that, you know, it was kind of like my reaction when the movie Life is Beautiful came out. And I said, there's nothing funny about the Holocaust. I this is offensive to me. This is the reaction that I have seeing that. It's to me, it's totally
inappropriate. Okay. And again, and you're not the only one. There was quite a bit of discussion when this came out about 10 years ago. Yeah. But for others, you know, it's in, yeah.
I have the same reaction to Life is Beautiful. But, and I had the same reaction to that when I first saw it years ago. But then I thought about it, and I think my great-grandmother who was killed in Auschwitz, I think she'd be happy that her great-great-grandkids are dancing and enjoying the music of the time and the culture of the time. So who knows?
Thank you. Yeah.
I was offended too, but that's a personal response, but in a more general term, it's like a moment in time, what is being taken here, and the history gets lost. I mean, Auschwitz was the final solution. What, you know, how much do people understand what led to Auschwitz, just being in this one spot, in this one moment? There's more to it.
Absolutely. I mean, here I would agree, it's sort of when these things, where I feel certain is that, you know, when the selfie and the VR, you know, of Auschwitz, and in many ways the whole trip to Poland, even if it's 8 or 10 days long, when these things become stand-ins for all of Holocaust education, then yes, much of the history, right, is lost. Because for one, the victim in Auschwitz, right, has very, very little agency, even if he can be a mensch or he can be cruel. But chances of getting out, you know, are the agency that comes, to me at least, a large part of the agency is saying, okay, let's look, for example, at the bystanders or those who were. So what if I was living on the other side of the wall in Warsaw and somebody came up to me and asked me to drive them? Okay, these raise questions that are exportable. I don't think that's all of it. I think to commemorate the dead is important, but it can't be everything, right? And to look at it from that point of view raises questions about, okay, so, you know, how would I react if I was not, you know, if I were there on the side? Would I have been willing to hide them? And these questions, when it's, what were you going to raise that with the VR of the tour of Auschwitz if that's all there is? Yeah.
The other thing is that what you get in the VR, it's someone else looking at it. When I went to Auschwitz, I had to walk around by myself. I couldn't tolerate anybody else around me. And I probably saw things very different parts of it, or in a different way, because I'm putting my own mindset into what I see.
Right.
This is someone else's interpretation. Even
yeah.
If it's
You're right. But so much of the VR is done in order to elide, to forget about the fact, even when it's a tour where he's narrating and he's telling a story, right, to elide the fact that it's someone's interpretation and to make the suspend that in the sense, okay, you are now there, right? As a matter of fact, you couldn't see what was here on this VR because a large part of it is done with drones. So you have an aerial view that that no one visiting, right, could see. But it is okay, it's this notion of being there that is made to surround you. Right? Yeah.
So a different point of view was, I like that so many young people were there. And the fact that I don't like them being on their phones, this is how they process so much in their lives. And it's, to me, it was better that they're there than if young people are not going.
Yeah, I mean, when we did we initiated a student exchange of students from Germany, from Tübingen, and Ben Gurion University students, where each of us did a course for a semester, and then they came over for a week, and we went there to study Holocaust memory and its representations. And we raised at the point, this was now 5 years ago, the question of selfies and broadcasts of social media. And my initial, at the time I was convinced that, this is just, cheapening and defying their memory. And they'd say, look, I've sent it out to friends. I have friends who could care less. And then when they saw that I was there, right, and I was posting about it, then they said, so, what's interesting? And they began to take interest and to study this for the first time. So.
I agree with her. That's my feeling too, is I feel like I can't judge because they're there, and there are a lot of young people who go to Auschwitz, which is a good thing, because there is a very well done museum there, so they are still learning and experiencing. I have a bigger issue with a lot of these VR films, because I think that there has to be context provided with it. So we actually had here the Majdanek one,
right,
we had on exhibit here for a while. But you really can't just, that can't be your lesson about the Holocaust. And while it is important to have, peer survivor testimony, if you walk through our museum, there's a lot of information before we get to the death camps, before you get to Auschwitz. I mean, the Holocaust, the survivors say, it didn't just fall from the sky. It didn't happen overnight. So you need to understand, so many things leading up to it. So these ER films have to be accompanied with, like, something, you know, a lesson plan. So that can't be how you learn about this history, because even if that's the only thing you're watching, let's say, I think it's great because not everyone can get to these sites, right? And it is important, but that can't be how you learn about it on its own. So
I agree, and I felt at the same time, I thought it was interesting that sound, when you're in the virtual reality, they're setting you up in an experience that they're driving, because they have the music, and so they're kind of filtering, you're getting this this experience that they're imposing on you with spiritual music to kind of, sway your emotions in a certain direction. And not, so you aren't experiencing
it
yourself.
It doesn't feel authentic.
It's not authentic.
Yeah.
Well, I want to say a little about this, authentic is one of these for, certainly as an anthropologist who studies also pilgrimage and tourism, is one of these landmine words. It's like you don't want to step on that, right? Because authentic, right? But if you think about how visits, again, when I started, how visits to Auschwitz are built, there's a tremendous amount of emotional framing very often of these visits, right? You're going there, all right, don't forget, you're going to, in the Israeli case, don't forget to take your flags and put your, your sweatshirts on. So, and the framing here even pulls the testimony of the survivor in a certain way. Because if you think about, the survivor, they don't hear all the story of the survivor. Let's say, for example, this is pre-selfies, right? We're talking 30 years ago. And the survivor would speak, he would tell his story in three when there was a framing in terms of place and ritual that pulled the story in particular ways and emphasized them, right? No less than the music, if you like, of the VR film. The survivor would talk in the bus, right? They'd been up half the night, and when the survivor would talk over the microphone, they'd all fall asleep, and the teacher had to go around and wake them up. The survivor would talk in places, tell his life story. Well, there are a handful of kids, who would listen, and the rest, it's ancient history. The survivor would talk in Auschwitz in the barracks, and then there, that was, he was the hero. So when I would gather a group together that had been there 5 years before, and I asked them, tell me, what do you remember about the trip? I said, oh, we remember our visit to Birkenau. I said, what do you remember about Birkenau? And I said, we were sitting on the floor of the children's barracks, and it was dark, and it was wet, and it was cold, it was really scary. And I said, did you have a survivor who accompanied you? He says, yeah, it was Miriam. So what do you remember about her? Well, she sat us on the floor of the children's barracks, and it was dark, and it was cold, and it was really scary. And what did Miriam tell you? So what really spoke to them, not everyone, but what spoke to many, was the fact that she was there, they were there. She could say, you see these barracks? Imagine what it was like, you feel how cold, imagine what it was like, and I didn't have a hot breakfast in me, right? And we were there in the middle of the winter. So it's this being there, this bodily presence, that very often trumps the story, the content of the story itself. And in that sense, the VR, or the music in the VR, right, works in the same way. And then for many, again, few of them, I think few people watch the VR 5 times and say, yeah, but, that's this story, are pulled in that way. And the survivor himself, remember, if you looked at that, survivor, this one, okay? So he stands on top, right, on you know, he has many stories and that he can tell. And the story that he's telling to the students there, with 150 uniformed, right, now the students there in front of him and all these flags, may be very different than what he feels when he gets back home in a week and, you know, and thinks about it. But when you stand there, if the last time he was there was as a prisoner and is now standing in front of this army of 150 kids and 20 Israeli flags, how can he not feel that there's some sense of closure or some sense of redemption? So the story is pulled in that way, like the music, if you know, I think, in many ways of the VR. Yeah.
Presentation. I just have to say that I personally found it offensive to see the survivor dancing with his grandchildren, and just because he's a survivor does not make it right. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, I found it incredibly offensive. And you know, I'm an educator, so I'm always thinking about how do you reach your students, right? And I think that, you know, when I see the pictures of the selfies, like, you know, the one in front of the carcasses,
yeah,
you know, and it's just like, people need a lesson in compassion.
Yes.
And before you're going to go there, how about thinking about other people who were there and their experiences, and not being so selfish and just, I need a selfie, but somebody's really going there to mourn, you know, right. And so I just think it's personally, you know, it's attractor of our society. I mean, that you know, compassion is not, you know, right, concern for other people and their experience.
I just want one caveat, and that is that the photos are not in front of the carcasses. The photos are in front of these monuments, right? And the carcasses you saw, this is a kind of...
No, I'm not talking about that.
Oh,
I'm
sorry.
I'm talking about the couple, and it was the image, yes, behind them of the carcasses.
Okay.
That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, I'm not talking about the ones that were doctored, which obviously are just...
You?
No, before that.
Yeah, that one.
Okay. So here, too, you see, the one on the left is the original posted photo. So it's just with blocks in the back,
okay,
of the memorial site.
Okay.
And the carcasses are a photo. This is what the kind of the reaction of whatever his name is. The artist did to say, look, to shame them, right? And to say, you know, you think you're standing in front of blocks? Look, you're standing in front of the carcasses of the dead. So he photoshopped these. So when they took this picture, again, they were standing in front of these blocks of the memorial.
Okay, and there's one other, I think, before of a couple that I found really disturbing, their expressions. Before this, you know, their expressions as if, you know, they were just like,
yeah, to that point, as someone who's involved in film for most of my
career. Speak a little bit louder.
To that point, as someone who's involved in film for most of my career, I wanted to say that the authenticity of some of the drone footage, while it looks, you might say, inauthentic, it does help one's mind recreate the idea of scope and scale, which is that around the camps, a lot of people's image of it is like the single entrance or the railroad tracks, whatever. But when you get into the drone footage, it shows you if you were stuck in one of those camps or if you had to jump out the window of a moving train, where would you go? It's just woods, or it's all Polish countryside or whatever. You'd be lost there. That's why in many ways they didn't go. So you have to understand that.
I would agree with you, but the question is, when that becomes, you know, the end, the end all, then one's lost a lot. Of course, one can, you know, go on.
But it does provide an emotional context.
Right.
And you were just talking about what people remember from being in the barracks or whatever. If you think about it, it's emotion. So music and the idea of the scope and the scale of the horror that surrounds you is not necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
If anyone has any more questions, Jackie.
Really good.
Thank you, Dr. Feldman.